So I'm not going to conclude with some recipe for how to get a general strike in the United States, or even in Chicago, or even in Toledo, or even in Cleveland, or whatever, Baltimore. But what I want you to think about, and maybe we can discuss, is this question of, well, let me put it this way. There are groups on the left, and because I'm living in Britain now, I see this all the time. They think the last word in radicalism is to call on the Trade Union Congress, their AFL-CIO, to call a general strike. So they're calling on them to call a general strike. This is about as likely as the TUC passing out rifles. This is not going to happen. So that idea that this is the radical demand, to me, seems mistaken, that real general strikes, real mass strikes, come out of the ability of one group to relate to what another group is doing, to pick up on that, and maybe to take the advice of the fireman the next time and do something. Oh, it's illegal. Well, yes, it's illegal. And I guess Mark Brenner said it last night or something, you know, if you're not willing to consider that idea, then, you know, how far are we going to get? We can talk about solidarity and all of that, but if we're not willing to do that. The other thing he said was really important, and the Madison people were saying this morning, we did not wait for permission. Don't call your international union. Say, guess what, we're going to organize a mass strike or a general strike. No, don't do that. It's easier to do that in decentralized unions than it is in highly centralized ones like, say, the UAW or something. But nonetheless, the idea that initiative locally, and when you're in the midst of a big struggle like they were in Wisconsin at that time, that you can talk to people about who's going to be next. Or better yet, you can organize your group to be the group that is next. And that's what really is important here. If you look back carefully at the history of all these things I'm talking about, they all ultimately, maybe a couple of exceptions, come from the grassroots. They come from people who are just fed up and who went and organized their fellow workers and people who were not in the same union to take this kind of action. Whether or not it was legal or not, even before Taft-Hartley, by the way, in America, common law told you that most of these things that I'm talking about were already illegal. It's a long history of the courts and all this, but nonetheless, you know, that was true back then, it's still true today. Take the idea of a plant occupation. All right, they did it in Chicago a couple of years ago, right? That's about as illegal as you can get. The common law of property tells you you cannot do that. They did it. They got away with it. I'll give you a couple of examples from Britain where, if anything, the laws are now even more difficult, if you can imagine that, particularly when it comes to secondary action or illegal action. There, to have a strike, you have to have a postal ballot. That takes 2-3 weeks. You have to give a week's notice. So this element of surprise is gone. Yet, there have been strikes and occupations. People, electricians did this recently, construction electricians. Construction engineers did it a couple of years ago. Workers in Visteon plants, that is export part plants, occupied their plants. Guess what? Nobody went to jail. No court actions. Nothing. What this tells you, I think, is that not that the state likes these things, but that the state sometimes worries if we try to repress this thing, might not it actually make things worse?